It is another edition of the Daily Grossi. Chris Oldak alongside me, our Browns analyst, Tony Grossi. Tone, we'll get to our position-by-position breakdown, the secondary here in just a second. But first, let's start with the idea that the Browns could be playing their season opener, not just on the road, out of the country in Brazil. Mm-hmm. Roger Goodell, the commissioner of the NFL, came out last night, NFL opening night for Super Bowl week, and said that the Philadelphia Eagles will be hosting the season opener on a Friday night. So this is actually after the Thursday night game. On Friday, they're hosting the game, and one of their home opponents is the Cleveland Browns. So, Tone, what do you think the likelihood is that the Browns will be opening the season out of the country?
I think the odds are fairly good that the Browns might be the opponent in that game, Chris. First of all, Browns haven't played overseas since 2017. So their time in the rotation is coming up. They were supposed to play in 2020 against Jacksonville in London. All those international games that year were wiped out by COVID. So it could be their turn to come back. You know, there's a rule that states in the NFL, every team is required to play a home game and a road game overseas over the next, I think it's 10 years. So the Browns' turn is coming up. Now, as to the other possibilities for that game, usually the NFL does not like to schedule divisional games over there. So let's eliminate Dallas, Giants, and Washington, Philadelphia's other home opponents from the division. That leaves teams like the Browns, Pittsburgh, Carolina, Atlanta, Green Bay, and I think there's one other team.
Jacksonville is the other one, but don't count them out because they're, you know, they're already doing their London games.
Right. Okay. So those five other teams, or that I mentioned, you got to look at who's been most recently to Europe or overseas. I know Atlanta was there a couple years ago. Carolina, I'm not sure about. I don't think Green Bay, they would take the Green Bay game, Chris, because that's a big draw for Philadelphia. That's taken away a pretty good, you know, home opponent for them. Then it might come down to Pittsburgh and Cleveland. All right, Pittsburgh has not played overseas since, I think, 2013. But they have some kind of, they have volunteered to play in Mexico City in 2025 and also a game in Dublin, Ireland, a few years later. And although that's not binding, when a team, you know, kind of volunteers a future game, the league tries to accommodate them. Mm-hmm. So that would, if they do accommodate them, would eliminate Pittsburgh, and the only team left would be Cleveland.
Yeah.
So we might find out about, we'll find out well in advance of the normal release of the schedule, which is in May. We might learn as soon as the combine or the owners meeting a few weeks after that, whether it's Cleveland playing in Brazil.
So if it isn't Brazil, Tone, there's still a chance that the Browns could play Jacksonville in London. Jacksonville is on the Browns schedule, and it's a road game for the Browns, which means there's a chance that it could be London. Now, if it were me, I would think between the two, do the Brazil game because you have all the time in the world to prep for it. You have a few extra days after the fact to get back into the States for week two. So I guess the lesser of the two evils in my mind would be Brazil, even though that's the longer trip.
Yeah, it's like a 12-hour trip, and the game is scheduled for Friday, the day after the traditional Thursday night opener. So it's game one for both Philadelphia and their opponent. And remember that the conclusion, the last preseason game to the first week of the season is about 17 days. So there's a long lead-in period there. The team that's traveling to Brazil could leave, I don't know, Monday or Tuesday for a Friday game, get in a few light workouts. And then since it's a Friday game, they'll be fully recovered for their next game the following Sunday. So it's very possible. Now, we know that the Browns are probably going to be on the road in week two because they have that Billy Joel and Rod Stewart concert at Cleveland Browns Stadium. So that would mean the Browns, if they're chosen to go to Brazil, would play their first two games on the road, which is not really unusual. Other teams have played both games on the road. It's never been a international game though, because this is the earliest international game, I think, ever, opening weekend.
Yeah. All right, Tone, we'll keep an eye on that. Like you said, we could hear something potentially as early as the combine here at the end of the month. Let's switch over now to our position by position breakdown, and we'll focus on the secondary today, where, Tone, I thought overall the first year in Jim Schwartz's defense, the corners and safeties really took to it.
Well, the cornerbacks loved playing in Jim Schwartz's system because it's predominantly man-to-man coverage, and the Browns' top three corners are all pretty good at man-to-man coverage. And, you know, the zone coverage that was favored by Joe Woods the previous three or four years, there were so many miscommunications and breakdowns. We didn't see a lot of that this year. And all three of the top three cornerbacks had pretty good years and were pretty much on the field a lot. Greg Newsome had his first interceptions of his career. Martin Emerson had four interceptions to lead the Browns. Denzel Ward only had two, but he had a pretty good year, made the Pro Bowl again. And the fourth corner, Cameron Mitchell, a rookie, had his first interception of his career. So I think the cornerbacks excelled in this system. The safeties had a few more injuries. Grant Delpit, Juan Thornhill, and Rodney McLeod, the last month of the season, they weren't even on the field, and the Browns were using their fourth, fifth, and sixth safeties. But Delpit's groin injury happened right after he got a new contract, you know, which secures his spot as a foundation piece of this defense for years to come. But I think the safeties also love the system. So I look for better things in year two.
Yeah. Sticking with the corners, there's a decision to be made about Greg Newsome and his future with this team. Kind of explain what the options are for the Browns headed into Newsome's fourth year.
This is probably the biggest issue on this position group, Chris. Greg Newsome was a first-round pick in 2021. He's entering his fourth year. That's the time where the team has to decide whether to pick up his fifth-year option. The deadline for that is May 2nd. It automatically guarantees his 2025 salary. And in a cornerback's case, drafted number 26, it's about $12 million, let's say, for the 2025 year. Now, that alone is a pretty high price for a guy who's probably the Browns' number three cornerback behind Denzel Ward and Emerson. So the Browns' options, they actually have probably four options. One is to just pick up the option. Second is to let him play his fourth year this year under his current contract and then risk losing him to free agency next year. Another one would be to extend his contract now, which would secure his future with the team and lower his cap number over the next couple of years. If he played under the 2025 50-year option, that's pretty high price tag for 1 year for a third cornerback. Or the fourth option would be, do you see him as surplus and a marketable trade asset? And I think that's the least option because, Chris, although I think there'd be a market for Greg Newsome, he could play as the number two cornerback for a lot of teams, if not this one, but others. But it's not like Andrew Berry to trade or give up on his draft picks.
Yeah.
It's not. I mean, they like Newsome. They think he had his best year as the nickelback primarily in Schwartz's system. I would think that there's a possibility he might be extended as their most favored option.
All right. Keep an eye on that. I'm going to throw something out there to keep an eye on. Not that it would be a trade straight up, but we've talked all offseason already. The Browns are looking for a top-flight wide receiver. I wouldn't be shocked if he was part of a package to maybe try to land one of those guys. So just something to keep an eye on here.
Yeah. Well, he's an asset. I'm sure other teams would want him. It's just tough to package players for players. I mean, you have to find the right match who wants to dump a receiver and who needs a cornerback.
Yeah.
If you find that match, that's a great dream match there. And I'm still not sure they would do it, but we'll wait and see. It's the number one issue of this position group.
The number two issue kind of plays into number one, and that's Denzel Ward's contract. How does his situation play into the rest of the secondary?
Denzel's entering the third year of his five-year big $100 million contract. And in the third year, the numbers get a lot higher. His salary cap number actually surpasses Myles Garrett and becomes number three on the Browns salary list behind Deshaun Watson and Amari Cooper, over $23 million. The Browns would like to reduce that, no doubt. And you reduce it by, you know, converting some salary into signing bonus, extending the years after that, either dummy years or new years with new dollars. Mm-hmm. So I would think that's, you know, that could be tied into what they decide to do with Newsome. If they want to create, they could create salary cap room by doing both, a new contract for Newsome and a restructured deal for Denzel Ward. So really, if that's the worst issues you have at a position group, they're in great shape because those are good problems to have. They have two good players, you know, that they want to keep. And there's a lot of flexibility to reduce those numbers.
Yeah. Tone, on the other side for the safeties, Rodney McLeod was one of those veteran pickups and he got hurt. Do you see a situation where he could be back with the team this year?
I do. Although he's 33, I think he'll be 34 for most of next year. But that's okay because he would be the third safety. Mm-hmm. He was very valuable the first year because he was the one player that had played in Jim Schwartz's system, and they helped get everybody up to speed with that. No doubt, the other safety veteran whose contract is up is Daron Harmon, who they picked up late in the year after all these injuries. I'm not too sure if we'd see him back, but they have DeAnthony Bell under contract, the young safety, and also Ronnie Hickman. The rookie undrafted player from Ohio State who had a pretty good year for an undrafted rookie. So if there is a need for one more safety, it probably would be a veteran one-year guy. And it could be some of the guys we mentioned, either Harmon or McLeod.
And Thornhill, okay season, but just marred by injury that lingered nonstop. And I think he was disappointed, some fans disappointed, but another guy that'll be back next year hoping to bounce back from those injuries.
Yeah, he was really disappointed. He had that calf injury. We know calf injuries can linger. If you try to come back too soon, they get worse. That's what happened to him. His contract, he was a free agent last year. You really have to get through the first 2 years of a free agent contract before you can think about moving the player. So I think he's safe for this year. They want to see the Juan Thornhill, who they thought they were getting, and get him healthy is the priority.
Yeah. Well, Tone, a lot of good stuff as always. A lot of things still to keep our eyes on. And another day, and I promise to all everyone listening, we'll talk a little Super Bowl as the week goes on, as we're just a few days away here between the Chiefs and the Niners for Super Bowl 58. Tone, great stuff as always. Appreciate the time.
Sounds good, Chris. Look forward to talking about the Super Bowl. We haven't mentioned much about it yet, but it's coming.
Yep, sure is.